Hi, I'm Yorgos Kallis. I'm a professor at ICTA, at the Autonomous University of Barcelona. I want to share with you my presentation for historical materialism 2019 in London. I'm sorry I couldn't make it there. It's a fantastic event and I feel very jealous of all of you there. We're going to enjoy 3 days of fantastic talks. My talk is based on my just published book on Limits and Malthus, and I want to share some thoughts with you today. I'll be around, I hope, for questions and answers after my PowerPoint presentation.
Socialists and Greens have spilled a lot of bad blood over the question of limits. So today I want to share with you some of my work done, where I try to redefine and defend the notion of limits as a revolutionary praxis. I want to move beyond tired dichotomies of the 1970s and reject once and for all the critique that if you defend limits, you must somehow be a Malthusian. We should tell apart, I have always felt, and this is my motivation for this talk, we should tell apart reactionary notions of limits, like the coming anarchy of Prophet of Doom, Robert Kaplan, or the lifeboat ethic of Garrett Hardin, and tell apart these reactionary notions of limits from notions of limits like those defended by activists in places like Standing Rock or Ende Gelände in Germany, mobilization against the coal power plants. Lumping all defenses of limits as Malthusian is analytically sloppy and politically wrong. To construct a more nuanced take on the notion of limits, we have to begin by understanding better what Malthus actually said. Malthus was wrong, and there is no doubt about it. But clarifying why precisely Malthus was wrong is crucial, I argue, for a more refined take on the question of limits. Malthus' essay is one of those classic works that academics like us feel comfortable citing without ever taking the trouble to read. Gareth Dale's 2012 paper on Malthus opened my eyes to how much we have misunderstood the content of the essay. Malthus, Dale explained, was actually an early apostle of capitalist growth, not limits. Dale's article made me sit down and read Malthus' essay carefully again, line by line this time. And then I searched more about the context in which Malthus wrote his essay, the reactions to it, and the afterlives of Malthus's ideas. Here, today, I want to share what I found and explain how it speaks to current debates about limits. First, I'm going to argue, Malthus was not a Malthusian, he was an economist. Of course, you know that he was an economist, but what I mean by that is that his theory was not one of limits to growth, as we've typically and conventionally have come to think of his work, but actually was one of postulating the assumption of a limitless human propulsion to grow without limits. Second, I will argue, the fiercest critics of Malthus at the time and after the essay were the Romantics, who ridiculed his postulate of a limitless human drive to multiply and populate the earth, a capitalist imperative dressed with the language of religion. Radical environmentalists, I argue, have inherited this romantic defense of limits, not Malthus's. As I show in my new book, Limits, Why Malthus Was Wrong and Why Environmentalists Should Care, Malthus did not predict, much less did he call for limits. Malthus invoked the specter of limit to advocate for growth. And in the name of growth, it was that he rejected redistribution, defending class society against revolutionaries. Without inequality, the poor will get lazy, Malthus argued in the essay. And if they are lazy, they won't produce enough. Malthus worried that if the poor had their basic needs covered, they would not work hard enough to produce more food, and then the population would stagnate, it would not grow anymore. It is funny to realize that unlike someone worried about population collapse or warning about the threat of population or of overpopulation, the way we have come to think of Malthus, Malthus, like his mentor at Cambridge, William Paley, for them too, population growth was the ultimate good. The greatness of a nation was actually measured by its numbers. Malthus and Paley were clerics, and for them clerics, God wanted us to multiply and populate the earth. Assuming a God-given command to have as many children as possible, Malthus concluded that the world is and will always be scarce. Against scarcity, the only thing we can do, save for tyranny, Malthus wrote, is to stay disciplined, forget these silly revolutions, and produce more. Scholars who have studied Malthus seriously, such as Robert Mayhew or Frank Elwell, also conclude the same. Malthus's own views have very little to do with those of modern-day environmentalists. Malthus claimed in the essay that there are no limits to resources or even to food. He left no doubt that he was against birth control. That much goes for his concern with population or overpopulation. Not for moral reasons, but as he explained, he rejected birth control because limits to population would remove a necessary stimulus to industry and growth. Malthus was not only a cleric, he was also an economist, the first actually with a university chair in political economy. He was the first, among others of course, to formulate the assumption upon which modern economics is founded, that of a human need to expand without limit. If wants are unlimited, as economists assume they are, then the world is scarce by definition, always and everywhere, not sometime or in the future. Scarcity, we know from the work of Lionel Robbins, and also for those of you who have studied economics, it's one of the first things we learn. Scarcity is the founding stone of economics. It's actually what the discipline is supposed to study. And this scarcity, economists have told us, can be confronted only by more work and by continuous growth. And this was also the main thrust of Malthus' essay, his main argument. Scarcity and progress in modern economics are then the two sides of the same coin. Growth promises everyone more tomorrow, but at the same time, economists repeat, as Malthus first put it, that there is never and there will never be enough for everyone to have a decent share. What Malthus did is that with one stroke, he both legitimated capitalism's drive for constant expansion and he managed to justify continued poverty in the midst of plenty. Engels and socialists after Engels challenged Malthus on two grounds. The quotations here are from Marx and Engels on Malthus, a book published in the 1950s. I think it's the best collection if you want to study what Marx and Engels said about Malthus. Basically, Marx said very little, and it was mostly Engels who engaged and criticized the essay. So Engels challenged Malthus on two grounds. One is correct in my view, the other one is wrong. The correct critique, I have it here on the green quotes, was that capitalism scarcity was socially produced. It was a result of enclosures which were meant and designed in order to produce a reserve army of cheap workers. A socialist system, Engels argued, would share what there is and make sure that everyone has enough. Under socialism also, interestingly, or under communism, Engels argued that we could easily limit population. And the assumption of population growth that was inbuilt in Malthus' model would not hold. Engels, of course, famously said, and that's what he's mostly quoted for, that too little is produced and that's the cause of the whole thing. What he meant here is that Malthus' theory is irrelevant for socialism because socialism would be able to produce much more than capitalism. Engels, I'm afraid, in this way accepted Malthus' foundational myth that there is not enough for all today. even if he did it in order to promise that there will be more tomorrow. He remained in this way trapped in capitalism's legitimating meta-narrative of a myth of scarcity, that there is not enough for everyone right now. The Romantics instead, more interestingly, mocked Malthus for thinking that what people want is to have as many children as possible. The Romantics praised free love, or the most daring among the Romantics. We can both limit and enjoy ourselves, they implied. We can enjoy sex without having children. And actually, in order to enjoy sex, we cannot have children every time we have sex, right? Malthus could never accept something like that, not only because he was a cleric, but also because if he did, then indeed there could be enough for everyone, as population could be satisfied within the limits of available production. And then a classless society, what Malthus was trying to disprove, would be possible. Precisely for that, Malthus could never accept birth control. It would go against his very argument, which was that there is a propensity for the population and a need actually for the population to grow without limit. In my book, I show how such romantic ideas among socialists, anarchists, or environmentalists articulate a revolutionary notion of limits, a notion of limits as a source of solidarity, freedom, and abundance. Consider, for example, Emma Goldman. Goldman called for birth control, not in the name of scarcity or to avoid the coming apocalypse. She wanted women to control their bodies and enjoy sex without having to worry about having scores of children. She wanted women to stop producing cheap workers for capitalist factories and dispensable soldiers for the imperial war machines. Limiting oneself was a revolutionary act against a system that wants us to want no limits. Like Goldman, those of us who defend degrowth today do not call for limits because the world is running out of stuff. We are not worried that growth might come to an end. We want to end growth and stop its catastrophic and meaningless path. We want limits. Limits in order to stop ecological and social destruction. Limits to stop in its tracks a capitalist system that knows no limits and is exploitative and ugly. Limits to leave space for others, human and non-humans. Limits, in this sense, are not the opposite of liberation. Limits are necessary for freedom. A pianist can make infinite music with a limited keyboard. Give the pianist, though, an infinite keyboard, and she or he would paralyze. Limitless choice is debilitating. Capitalism's limitless and senseless pursuit of evermore is not freedom. It is actually slavery. This call for what I call in my book self-limitation is different from Malthusian views of limits as a natural property found in the encounter of our bodies and desires with a stingy world. The atmosphere is not a limited sink. This is actually a very terrible way to think of the sky. It is we who should limit emissions so as not to screw the climate. The limit is on us, not on the sky. There are no natural limits that forces us to do this or that, as we often hear, but there is an ethical and political imperative not to do everything that can be done, not to despoil the beauty that we have inherited. The concept I use of self-limitation is a concept introduced by Greek thinker Cornelius Castoriadis. Castoriadis distinguished between heteronomous societies that attribute their limits to an external source, say God, the Ten Commandments, or the free market. He distinguished heteronomous societies from autonomous societies that are aware that it is themselves in their collectivity that define their limits. Self-limitation, Castoriadis argued, is not about constraining, but about defining collectively as societies our limits. Collective self-limitation is the essence of democracy. This is why capitalism has always had very little tolerance for real democracy. Granted, capitalism right now limits the poor. A narrative of limits faces today, as it did in Malthus' time, an uphill battle to inspire those who are forced to live with less than enough. But those who have little want enough, not ever more. A politics of ever more is what capitalism has always sold to people, to to the dispossessed and the propertied alike. Ever since Malthus, limits to few have been justified in the name of more for everyone. Austerity was never implemented for the sake of ecological limits or international solidarity. Austerity is pursued in the name of growth. Enrico Berlinguer, historical leader of the Italian Communist Party, saw that early. Back in 1977, and as neoliberal austerity was taking shape, he advocated instead an austerity of solidarity, an austerity of living simply so that others may simply live, an austerity of private, not public, consumption. A wisdom of self-limitation and sobriety has featured in Western and Eastern civilizations throughout the ages. It is a latent common sense still active today. Before surrendering our imagination to capitalism's pseudo-luxury of infinity pools, before we fell in this trap of these capitalist dreams, to be a revolutionary meant to live also frugally, more frugally than the most frugal of ecologists would live today. Not in order to save money or even save the planet, but out of solidarity and respect for those in need, and out of rejection for the meaningless dreams capitalism had to offer. Can a powerful politics be constructed around this common sense of enough? That's my question to you. Thank you.